Welcome to what we see as a kind of experiment. And frankly, we're not sure how it's going to work out, but one thing we are sure of is that it won't work out unless everyone here also participates. Jim and I, let me explain how this presentation came to be planned. About 2 years ago, my family and I visited Jim and Tira in their place in the smack in the East Oregon forest, where we had a wonderful visit, traveled around quite a bit. And as we were bumping around in the back of their truck going here and there, up to Crater Lake and down, we realized that we were having some truly fascinating discussions, or at least fascinating for us. And we couldn't help comparing how much more interesting these were compared to what it was usually like listening to papers at a conference. So we wondered whether it might be possible to somehow recapture some of that same dialogical spirit at a conference. And that's where we decided to try to do something rather different. Instead of presenting papers, what Jim and I proposed to do is talk for a few minutes, probably no more than 10 minutes each, making a short preliminary statement. And then at the end of that, we're hoping to simply engage in a dialogue with each other up here in front of you on the same issues that have been raised in those papers.
We're going to try to keep a very informal tone about this whole thing, and yet try to focus on some of the what we consider some of the most critical problems in this Buddhist-Christian dialogue. Okay, so let me just start with telling you a little bit about myself, and then what our perspectives are, because we have very different perspectives, but they seem to be complementary about these issues. I grew up in New York in a Catholic family, and when I was about to go to college, I was thinking about, you know, questions of meaning, and I figured I'd become a theoretical physicist because that's how you would find some meaning. That was the days of science. And at that point, I went through a long and often difficult conversion to become a Catholic. The very things that I had grown up with were obviously hadn't penetrated very deeply if I thought that I need to be a theoretical physicist to find some meaning. Through that process, I began to see that there were whole riches in the tradition that I had never heard about, that now I began to get these little glimpses of the Catholic mystical tradition, which you wouldn't hear of like in the normal parish church, or on the other hand, what you could call a Christian philosophical or metaphysical tradition. And these things I found very exciting because it was all now alive. It was like an inner journey that I had embarked on without even, intending it. And so after quite a while, Tira and I were together, and we decided that we're facing, we have a couple little kids, and I need a job. I have some indifferent jobs, and we decide, well, what we really want most out of life was some time, lots of time, to pursue these kinds of interests. And so we moved out into the middle of a forest in near Crater Lake in Oregon, and tried to build our own house. We didn't have a clue, so we're out there, you know, with a book in one hand and the hammer in the other, trying to figure out what to do. But the impetus behind it was to have the time to explore and kind of rediscover this Christian mystical and metaphysical traditions, and then bring them into dialogue with Zen Buddhism, first of all because of our deep interest in Zen, with Jungian psychology, and with a kind of new sense of the earth, a simpler and more sustainable way of living. Okay, so that's where I am coming from when I'm addressing these questions, from those years being out there. We've been out there over 20 years, and saying, now, when I look at Zen Buddhism now, I'm looking at it from that focus. One time, David, he already alluded to this article he wrote. It was on the cloud of unknowing, and back in 1989, and he wrote a little footnote because he had conducted an informal survey of the Christian students of Yamada Roshi, his own teacher. And he had asked them various things, and I'll quote his conclusion. "The most interesting result was a division among Christian Zen teachers between those who want to maintain a strong distinction between Zen practice and Christian practice, and those who see them as aiming at the same thing, and therefore to be eventually united, which seems to mean using mostly Zen practice with Christian terminology." Now, as I said, this was an informal survey, but it seemed to me that it pointed at one of the really deep issues in this whole dialogue. I'd probably phrase it my own way and say, what is the relationship between enlightenment, Buddhist enlightenment, and Christian contemplation? Are they the same thing? Are they two different things? This has almost become like a koan to me, a question I can't escape. And so I've pondered this for a long time, and I have sometimes I feel I have a glimmer of an answer, but the answer seems so out of sync with many things that are happening that I'll have to leave it. I'll just have to present it and let you see what you think of it. And I think it'll emerge during the course of our dialogue. Now, it's my feeling that if we say that Zen enlightenment is the same as Christian contemplation, or another way of putting it is if we say that they're both aiming at this same identical non-dual goal, then it does a lot of things to Christianity, because then Christianity seems to lose a lot of its distinctive nature. Then the kind of language of Christianity almost begins to look like some kind of mythological language that needs to be kind of deconstructed to get at in a more direct way the real goal there. It's almost as if why would you want to go through all this kind of production in Christianity when you could do it more directly with Zen and just, you know, leave aside the accidentals. I really don't feel that identification is correct from my point of view. I see the two things as deeply interrelated inside us and in so many people's interior journeys, but somehow distinct. Maybe you could say different formalities or different aspects of this great mystery, but distinct in such a way that to tend to identify them is to create all sorts of other problems. If I look at Zen enlightenment from the point of view of Christian mysticism, I see really big differences. Because on the one hand, I'm looking at a relational love mysticism, and on the other, I'm looking at some kind of non-dual mysticism, if you want to use those words, or non-dual experience. And I don't want to collapse this relational love mysticism into the non-dual experience and say that it's just because the Christian mystics didn't take that final step that they're talking in dualistic categories. I don't feel that that's a good solution. And when I'm talking about this relational love mysticism, I think every great tradition, Buddhism included, has a relational aspect to it. It's like these two currents, the non-dual and the relational love aspects, flow through Hinduism, and I think they're in Buddhism, and you can certainly find them in Islam and so forth. So I think we're dealing with two big rivers of, two distinct kinds of mystical experience here. One final point. When it's a question of looking at Zen enlightenment from a Christian point of view of Christian metaphysics, that's an approach that I don't think that is done a lot, primarily because people equate Christian metaphysics with some kind of academic, overly conceptual philosophy that now has been gratefully put to rest with the fall of Thomas kind of scholasticism and all this. I understand that because it was presented usually in a very poor way. Yet at the same time, there is a tremendous depth in that tradition, and it has, there's ways to make it come alive so that metaphysics isn't some abstraction, it's simply a way to gain insight into the very ground of being. I actually think that this kind of metaphysics, if it could ever be kind of recovered, is a wonderful partner for dialogue with Zen Buddhism, because both of them are really very metaphysical, but in different ways. Zen, in a deeply non-conceptual way, is experiencing the very root of things. And Christian metaphysics, in its own way, is trying to discover the very isness of things, and the root of that isness. It's almost, you could say, that the proper metaphysical name of God is. Okay, that's where I'm coming from. Now we'll hear from David.
Those of you who haven't had a chance to visit them in their home don't have a sense of this, but there's really a sense that they are actualizing it and living it in a very deep fashion. You know, they talk about the simple life and they live it, and they've managed to find a way to do that. And I'm still feeling the effects of that visit. I'm not going to tell you about how I was raised as a Catholic and how I became a Zen Buddhist. What I'd like to do is suggest, as I said, a different model of how we can understand the relationship between Buddhism and Christianity. I don't think it's an especially profound, certainly not a complicated model, it's quite simple. And my guess is the fact that I haven't come across it expressed in this form says more about my ignorance of the history of Buddhist-Christian dialogue than it means that this is anything original. But the one way I start is perhaps original or unknown to many of the people here. I'd like to start off with Emanuel Swedenborg, Swedish mystic and philosopher that I still believe is a very important resource for this kind of dialogue, because I believe he himself operates as a kind of a bridge between the two, Buddhism and Christianity. But of course, there's a lot of strange things in Swedenborg who talked about visiting heaven and hell, and he is rather difficult in a number of ways. Perhaps it's not so odd to talk about him here in this Scandinavian environment. Anyway, the one concept that I want to borrow today is Swedenborg's concept of influx. Swedenborg says that God is not so much a separate being that we can relate to. Rather, God is better understood, you know, most essentially, most universally, as the life-giving force which is shared by every creature that inhabits the universe. God's energy is what vivifies all of us. In fact, God, you could say, is the substance of the cosmos. So already he escapes the kind of dualism that we so often fall into when we try to understand and try to relate God. God is our own true essence. As he says, God alone is life. From his life, he gives life to every man as the sun of the world, with its whole essence, which is heat and light, flows into every tree, every shrub, and every flower, every stone. Each object draws its own portion from the common influx. He gives it to all, and he gives to man the ability to take either little or much. Without this influx, we would instantly fall down dead. Perhaps we're familiar with the concept of influx, but what is especially important for our purposes today is that he doesn't talk about a single influx. For Swedenborg, there is a dual influx. We experience it in two ways. Just as we experience the effect of the sun as both its heat and its light, so Swedenborg says we experience God's influx in two fashions: as understanding and as love. He talks, in fact, the title of one of his books is Divine Love and Divine Wisdom. So we experience this influx in two fashions. Love refers to the warmth, to the heart, to our intentional life. And the wisdom, the understanding, refers to light, and not to the head, but to the lungs, curiously for him, and to the discernment. He says that love exists in wisdom, and wisdom becomes present in love. But both are from the divine sun. For Swedenborg, the metaphor here with the sun is actually more than a metaphor. God in heaven is experienced as something like a sun, radiating both heat and warmth. Now, what does this imply for the Buddhist-Christian dialogue? I think it actually implies a lot for a lot more than the Buddhist-Christian dialogue, because in this difference between Buddhists and Christians, perhaps between Jim and I think is the essential problem, or the most fundamental problem of mysticism, the problem of resolving impersonality, the impersonal absolute, with a personal God. I mean, those of you familiar with other forms of religion, well, everyone here, I'm sure, you can think of the difference in Advaita between non-dual Advaita of Shankara and Vishishtadvaita, right? The two, which is superior, which is the real, which is the final, which is subordinated to the other. And of course, we always have to keep in mind that it's not simply a matter of resolving Buddhism and Christianity here, that both of these are present within Buddhism and within Christianity. Christianity, just to remind us, has also its non-dual absolute, its impersonality in the form of mystics such as Eckhart. And likewise, Buddhism, as we know, has very strong streams of devotional Pure Land. So it's not so matter It's not just a matter of resolving the difference between the two religions, but almost an aspect within each religion. The difference being, perhaps, that in Buddhism we emphasize the impersonal more than the personal. Anyway, you can already see pretty clearly where I'm going with this one. Following Swedenborg's double influx, which I take very seriously, I think that we have two basic types of human faculties. We have to distinguish our understanding from our will and our love. And that in this case, neither one of them is reducible to the other. And both are necessary, but they imply different kinds of spiritual paths, which therefore inevitably conceive of the goal in different ways. And although each path implies the other, they are in fact quite distinguishable and irreducible. Buddhism, especially as practiced in the West, most often focuses on purifying the mind. That's what we're doing when we're meditating. We're letting go of concepts, mental phenomena that interfere with our experiencing the impersonal absolute. And the idea is to transform these delusions into prajna. Now, what is prajna? To some extent, prajna refers to perceiving the world in a different way. We perceive its insubstantiality, its impermanence. We experience the world and ourselves as no self. But more profoundly than this, prajna is not just a matter that we have a different content to our awareness. Most profoundly, we are thinking, we are experiencing the mental in a very different way. And I think we can see this most clearly in the case of Zen. If you look at the Zen dialogues that we're all familiar with, what's being looked for there is not that the student has an understanding of Buddhist teachings, but that by the kind of spontaneity that's expected there, it's showing that there's nothing interfering with the flowing up, with the influx of the understanding. Somehow the understanding has been purified to be non-dual and to be spontaneous, so that we don't grasp onto concepts in the way that we were doing before. To purify this, then, is to allow our thoughts to arise in a different way. It's not to eliminate thoughts, as some people think, especially in the early stages of practice. The idea is not to get rid of thoughts. There's nothing wrong with thoughts in themselves. It has to do with the kind of distortions that they're subject to. And we're trying to purify that mental faculty so we can experience this influx in a more direct and unmediated way. And I think we all have some little glimpse of this. This is what we mean by creativity. You know, so many creative people, most obviously musicians and poets, talk about how when they are creating, it just comes to them. It's not something that they themselves do. They're not self-conscious about it. It's something they laboriously create. It's almost as if they get out of the way and this arises by itself. It's not the case that it's not them either. They are this influx, which is then purified. Sometimes we joke about Bach and Beethoven, that their music comes from God, comes from the divine. Well, I want to take that literally. I think that there was something about those, about some of the greatest composers. I mean, Beethoven said that his music came from God. I believe it did. I believe that somehow he was able to find a way where something was able to emerge. Bach, Mozart, other classic examples. Another way to approach this is by asking the traditional spiritual question, who am I? Or who is thinking? Think of somebody like Ramana Maharshi. What was his method? It wasn't meditation in any conventional sense. It was asking this deep question, who am I, and trying to get a sense of that. In the case of the Zen Japanese tradition, we have Bunkyo, who asks, you know, who is hearing this sound? Who is the I that is hearing this particular sound? The answer, of course, is not I in any traditional sense, but it's rather the sense that there's something that my sense of self can never grasp. So that when one has this experience, the way we experience it is that in a way we never understand where our thoughts are coming from. This creativity, we experience the outflowing, but the ground of it, it's as if it springs up spontaneously from a fathomless well that can never be grasped. In other words, the task for understanding is not to grasp where these thoughts come from, where these mental phenomena come from, but rather to live that, to become vessels or vehicles for this spontaneous life to come forth. To embody that flux, to continue to remove the kinds of mental impurities that keep us from living that way, so that the divine can flow into and through us. Now, the parallel, of course, with love is very deep, with the will. I've been talking about the understanding, the intellectual, the mental faculty, but I think there's a almost complete parallel with love and the will. But there's one significant difference, that if you're talking about love, love by its very nature tends to be more relational. Again, the love isn't something that I have, but something that flows into me, something that I participate in, so that somebody who has this experience of the opening up of the heart. Is this something that I do? No, it's, as it were, something that I let go and allow to happen, to flow into me. But what's interesting about this is that when we have this experience, there seems to be something infectious about it. But compare, if you will, the kind of practice that Shakyamuni could do, and say the Tibetan sages in the caves of Tibet, with the kind of practice that this love involves. I mean, we can imagine Shakyamuni under the Bodhi tree, meditating by himself and coming to this non-dual awareness in his mind. But I can't imagine Jesus operating in the same way. You see, the idea of love involves relata, involves something that is loved and someone that is loving. Even though it's something that is an influx that flows into and through us, in order for this to be a practice, in order for this to develop in our lives, we need other people. We need the people around us. We need our families. We need our neighbors. And I think that's what we see in the case of somebody like Jesus. I mean, Jesus had this opening, which transformed him, but you know, he's not going to ask the question of, like Shakyamuni, whether anyone will understand this, should I just go off and wander in the woods. I mean, this opening inevitably leads him to want to share it with other people. He has this great experience, and he wants to love other people. And by loving other people, this becomes infectious, and he helps other people themselves have this similar experience. Again, the love isn't something subjective. This is what I want to emphasize. It's non-dual because it's not something that I have or I do. It's something that I participate in. It's greater than me. It's something that flows into me. And all I can do is open up in a way that helps this to flow more purely by removing the kind of obstacles that would keep me from experiencing and transmitting that love. Why don't we experience these influxes all the time? Well, Swedenborg says we do. I mean, we're experiencing them right now. It's just that it's something about the nature of our own minds that interferes with them. We're distorting them. We're unable to let go and step into the pure stream. We have to control it. And I think one way to understand that has to do with the sense of ground, that in a way, in order to experience these influxes purely, you have to let go of yourself. And this is terrifying. It really does mean becoming ungrounded in the sense of not trying to make yourself real. Usually, mentally, we try to make ourselves real by clinging to specific concepts, especially antithetical bonding, right? I'm male, I'm not woman, I'm American, I'm not Japanese, I'm Republican, I'm not Democratic. Well, that's not true. But you know what I'm getting at. And in the case of the love, you know, we distort the love in terms of becoming attached to very particular possessions, which for us, you know, it's a way of gaining a particular kind of security, a particular kind of grounding. And the challenge of the influx, of course, is that when you're experiencing this influx, because it comes from a bottomless pit that we can never grasp, there is no grounding. And that's the irony of it. It's actually experienced phenomenologically as something that I'm empty, you know. I don't know where it's coming from. Mozart, Bach, they can never know the ground from which the music pours forth, or the poetry arises, or why we say the thoughts that we do. But the irony, of course, is that to open up and let go in this way is to experience the only possible grounding, according to Swedenborg, which is this grounding in the divine. Again, something we can never grasp, something that we can only open up to. Okay, I've talked too long. Just to conclude, I think you can see the basic point here that Buddhism, I think, is emphasizing the intellectual path of purifying the mind, or that's more important than Buddhism. Both religions have both. I think that Christianity is emphasizing the more relational, transformative path of opening up and experiencing love. Perhaps it's needless to say that I think both paths imply the other. As Kant might say, wisdom without love is impotent, but love without wisdom is blind. And finally, this also makes the only sense that I can make out of the Trinity, which I confess as a non-Christian theologian scholar has always seemed very strange to me. But this implies the Trinity in the following way. The influx is itself the grace, the Holy Spirit flowing into us. The source, which we can never grasp and never really understand, but simply open to, is the Father or the Mother or the Absolute. And the Son or the Daughter is all of us who open up to this influx. That's the only sense I can make of the Trinity, and I think I've spoken too long. Now, having said that, my question, my challenge to Jim is, number one, do you agree, is that consistent with your understanding of the relationship between them? I mean, it seems to me that there are some things here that might be consistent with, say, Catholic Thomism, but I'm not sure that, I mean, if we all agree in this, do we need Thomism?
I certainly agree with the overall overall picture, in the sense the way you so graphically describe it's sort of like the thoughts or the coming out of this void or this ground or whatever you'd like to call it, but I think there's more going on here, and so I wonder if there's disagreement underneath this kind of general agreement, or sort of a phenomenological agreement. Mm-hmm. I have no doubt about the reality and power of the Zen experience. I think that we probably differ about the nature of this ground, okay? And I have no doubt about both traditions having wisdom and love, but from the Christian side, there's different kinds of wisdom. There is a kind of metaphysical wisdom that looks into the ground of being, and then there's a mystical wisdom which almost combines knowledge and love. It has knowledge coming through love. It's as if you love strong enough and long enough and were purified enough that a certain different kind of knowledge would come through that love. So
is that the same kind of knowledge that I was talking about? Is it the same as saying that the one implies the other if you go very far along the path, or is it different?
I'm not sure it's the same, because the way you're describing it is sort of putting it all, you know, eliminating distinctions that I'm not sure that I would want to eliminate. It's sort of like the unknowability of the ground. But, and now to get back to you, on this unknowability of the ground, there's certainly a whole Christian tradition that agrees with that, this kind of apophatic tradition. At the same time, what's the relation between the ground and us? You know, ultimately, what's the relationship between the ground and us?
Okay. For me, the fact that the ground is unknowable or ungraspable is very important. I mean, that's another way of understanding the claim that we often hear, you know, that the absolute is beyond concepts. Because we flow out of it, we're not going to be able to understand it or grasp it. It's like we're a manifestation. The flower doesn't really understand the roots. It manifests the roots. But this has implications for our theologies in another way too, in a very Buddhist way that you might want to take issue with here, that therefore it doesn't mean that we have to eliminate concepts, although that's one way to go, and at a certain point it's necessary in the path, but it means that we can have a large number of different types of conceptual systems or theological categories that can be employed here. But then they're evaluated and understood according to the Buddhist idea of upaya, that a particular set of concepts, including the one that I have just presented, using Swedenborg's two influx, the value of this is simply insofar as whether it helps lead us to that kind of experience, how much it promotes that experience. It's not as though in and itself or any other conceptual system is necessarily true with a capital T, that this is the superior set of categories. It's simply one way to try to describe the process. And what we end up with in the world is, I think, a large number of theological, religious systems, all in their own way, trying to promote this kind of experience, trying to describe it. But it's very important not to see, then, that any one of those has priority in and of itself, such as, say, either the Zen one or Nagarjuna or Thomism. The criterion is really a matter of upaya.
I guess I'd ask you then, all right, there's different conceptual systems, but are they leading to the same goal? Are they leading to the same thing? Think back to your survey where some of the Christian students identified him and some didn't. What would you do?
I'm not sure I understand the question, but I'll answer it as if I do, okay? After saying just now that you can't offer a conceptual system that sort of is absolute, in a way, of course, what I've tried to do is offer a master system within which all the others can be plugged, so we can enjoy the paradox or the self-refutation of that. I mean, obviously, not all religious notions are going to bring us to the same place, right? So how do we understand the different places that they take us? One important distinction has to be made is that I think there's something between a living categorical system, a way of talking that might be very alive at one point, that is very salvific, that there has certain power to it, might at another point become stale and dead and therefore losing its liberatory power. I mean, I'm thinking of one Zen master that I know who, you know, early in his life, I think after his enlightenment, he had a very deep experience, and as a result of that, you know, a particular way of talking about that experience sprang up for him. And I think in his early years, this was very powerful because it was very dynamic. But I think by the time he got old, I could see that he'd been saying the same sort of thing for a long time, and exactly the same categories that were quite powerful, and I think touched people and really help them. By then they were becoming sort of repetitious and stale, and they no longer had that kind of fresh quality that would sort of bring something out of people. So it's not only the case that we need different systems, but we also, over time, the same system has to be replaced simply because we're different people and because of the way we, living in a different world.
You know, I can certainly agree with that, but what I'm trying to get at is this ground, almost this vast emptiness. So here's the ego, and here's this tremendous, whatever you want to call it, this whole other ground out of which these creative things like the music come and everything. So let me try to sharpen it this way. Why can't we say that there's different dimensions in this vast ground? For example, why can't we say there's a psychological unconscious that the people in the various psychoanalytic movements tap into with dreams and archetypes and so forth? But sometimes those guys end up trying to kind of think the whole of the ground is this psychological unconscious and you don't need anything else. For example, you don't need any religious traditions because you have your Jungian or whatever thing it is. I'd also like, so from my point of view, I think there is a psychological unconscious that is a dimension beyond the ego, which is constantly influencing us.
Kind of intermediary between the process I was talking about. Intermediary between the sense of self and the pure influx.
You could put it that way in some of its aspects, probably functions that way. But why not say that there is also a what you could call a metaphysical unconscious, a kind of this kind of what happens in Zen, or where you have this experience of the kind of the root of things, the oneness of things, and then it comes out, it seems to come out in Zen almost an identity between emptiness and form. That form is emptiness and emptiness is form. But in any event, there is this metaphysical dimension. You know, maybe the word's bad because we have all these kind of academic philosophical notions, but I'll use it anyway. But why not say that there is also what we could call a mystical unconscious? And so there's knowledge and love connected with the metaphysical dimension of things, but there could be another kind of knowledge and love connected with the mystical dimension of things. And so instead of trying to put them all in one system or one overarching thing that you seem to be doing, couldn't we differentiate them and see that there are different dimensions in this emptiness?
Well, if we're going to compare, the virtue of comparison is that, you know, you're showing both similarities and likenesses, and unless you're doing both of those, the comparison doesn't really work. So what I've tried to do is bring in the two separate influxes, as I've put it, and show how they're related to each other. But I mean, you're suggesting about all these different, but whereas I'm trying to sort of bring a unitary system that makes sense of the difference, if you're going to offer as an alternative a bunch of different unconsciouses, I don't think it's adequate to do that unless you're going to show how they relate to each other. You know, what's really going on there? Why do we need them? So it's not clear to me if you're offering a modification of the kind of very simple model that I've offered, or if you're saying that that model is inadequate because there's all kinds of other things going on that, you know, it's refuted because it's too simple and there's too many other things going on. One other thing I want to add about emptiness here, and I think this is a very important point, that I think the model that I have suggested implies emptiness in at least two fashions. And I think this is found within the Mahayana tradition. And often we confuse the two. When we're talking about emptiness, we go from one to the other rather quickly, not realizing it. And within the Buddhist tradition, you know, there's these two interpenetrate and sometimes get confused and sometimes go their own separate way. One sense of emptiness is the emptiness of the ground. Okay, you can call that, if you want, a kind of metaphysical emptiness. And yet, the whole point that I was trying to make is that there's an because our knowing and because our loving comes from this, it's something we can never know. The emptiness is simply the fact that it's something we emerge from. We can never grasp it. And therefore, we have no sense of what its qualities are. That's one sense of emptiness. The other sense of emptiness is the sense that Nagarjuna uses it, that emptiness refers to a certain kind of relativity of systems. So this would be more referring to the way that I'm talking about how we use conceptual systems, why it is that we might use Buddhist language in one context and Christian language in another context, or psychological language in another context. Rather than making emptiness a term that we build a metaphysics upon, which I think, frankly, the Kyoto school gets stuck on, I think they're stuck in this fashion. Emptiness in the sense, shunyata in the sense that Nagarjuna is using it, is much more this sense of relativity and the fact that there's no particular system that's going to be adequate or has any superiority to other kinds of metaphysical or categorical systems.
Yeah, I think I understand those two points, and yet it almost seems implicit in what you're saying that when you say that, you know, the emptiness, you can't differentiate or distinguish qualities in it and so forth, is sort of, in final analysis, comes out to saying that what we're dealing here with is a non-duality. But if it's a non-duality, where do we leave Christianity, which believes it can understand something about the nature of this emptiness? Okay? Because the whole premise is that it knows something about this emptiness. Put in another language, Don Mitchell, in his book on spirituality and emptiness, was talking about the near side of mysticism, which is sort of like what you're talking about. And then he's saying that from a Catholic perspective, there's a far side, the reality of the Trinity. Okay? Now, from your position, what you seem to, you're going to ultimately have to see the Trinity or God as a person as a kind of construct we have created to try to picture the emptiness, but there can be no way that we could know anything like that.
So the question is whether I've constructed in my simple model, you know, something that's really neutral that grasps the relationship between the two, or if I haven't, as we always seem to do, really constructed a Buddhist model that finds a place for Christianity within it. Yeah, and it's very much the case. I think John agrees here. It's very much the case that from this model, there would be nothing absolute or nothing, you know, privileged about Thomism or any other metaphysical system, except to say it again, insofar as that helps us to walk along this path or to help us experience this kind of influx that I was talking about.
And I think that brings up another point, because when you kind of reduce all the conceptual systems to skillful means to have this certain, what I am admitting to be wonderful and very important experience, you also take a whole view of concepts that differs. Okay, the concepts, you could easily use one set or use another because you're after the experience which you've already said transcends the concepts. Within Christianity, we basically have a more of a continuity between concepts and hopefully what they're mediating, so that we can't switch as quick. Traditional Christianity, okay? And so that's one of the points that I think, you know, that we're differing on, how you're using the concepts. And it gets back to this same thing. But I sort of want to change it and approach the whole issue from another point of view. It's sort of like when we're calling this ground God, we're saying that there is a distinct person, however much you must purify that notion, that we are relating to. But that is kind of ruled out from the kind of structure you're presenting.
In terms of the model that I've presented, then perhaps we can say that there's no subspecies aeternitas, that this model, that I'm not looking at this model from somewhere above it or below it, but that the only possibility is to be somewhere within the model. And of course, if that's the case, then where I am is the intellectual, the understanding, the mental faculty here. That whereas I purport to be offering some kind of overview, what I'm really doing is understanding the two as the understanding can do, and it's the only way that the understanding can do it. And so what I understand you to be suggesting, Jim, is that if one is doing it, if one is even presenting the same model or experiencing, I guess you can't present it because that's what the understanding is, right? But if you're with the non-dual love, the influx and participation in love, if you're experiencing that rather than talking about it as I am now, then you're experiencing it not only relationally in the sense that you're loving people around you and sharing that, but you're also sensing that you're experiencing the source of that love as a person, and that that's how the personality inevitably comes in. And of course that's true for Swedenborg. It's interesting. He has this kind of ambiguity within him. Sometimes he talks about God as something impersonal and universal, and yet he's also very much a person for him. And he claims to have experienced this, of course. But there is exactly the same ambiguity within Swedenborg. Does that make sense to you? Yeah, is that what you understand?
And I think that's at the root of a lot of this, because I think you could, it's like, I think it was Funan, he was writing his death poem, and one of the lines was, out of the void leap wooden lambs, okay? The poem is really very good. I mean, it's sort of like...
Loses something in translation.
Yeah, right. whereas if you take John of the Cross, and he starts off one of his great poems, where have you hidden yourself, my beloved? Okay? And in his mind and heart, he was in pursuit of this beloved. And so he's writing love poetry, and I guess what I'm saying is I don't want to end up in a place where his love poetry is a veiled way of describing an unknowable void, okay?
I haven't been reading John of the Cross lately, but I have been reading Rumi, and it's very much the same sort of thing, this passion, this search for the beloved. Yes. So I guess I agree with you there. I wanted to go back to this whole point of concepts. I tried to say it. I'm not sure how clearly I said it, but I do want to emphasize again that the influx of the understanding, or this pure arising in the understanding, in the intellectual fashion, that this does not involve an emptiness of concepts. Well, no, it does involve emptiness, but without denying concepts. It's not a matter that concepts are bad. There's a sense in which you have to escape them, as it were, to fall into the emptiness from which they arise, to let go into that emptiness. And yet, then we experience, as it says in one of the Zen sutras that we often chant, thoughts too arise from the mind. Okay, thoughts. There's nothing wrong with thoughts in themselves. Let's not blame the victim. It has to do with the way the thinking is done. There's some kind of interference, the way the thoughts are clung to. If the thoughts are not clung to and used in various ways to fixate ourselves, to secure or ground ourselves, then the thoughts can be allowed to experience, just like the music or just like the poetry. So what we get then is empty thoughts. Thoughts that are empty in the sense that they arise from the emptiness, also empty in the sense that there's nothing absolute about them, but they have this quality that we can play with them, just as delight in them. Just as we delight in the music of Bach and Beethoven, we can delight in the poetry of Rumi and John of the Cross, and we can also benefit from the conceptual systems of St. Thomas and the Zen sages.
Do you think we can now just open up the whole discussion? So this is the reason of the circle. We just want to continue this dialogue with your own questions and own concerns. So please. You read the Christian mystics, and they're talking of a different language and a different kind of experience. Now, is this because, then you read the Zen masters and they're talking in a different way. They're not talking the same
the same, about the same? Are they not talking about the same thing, or are they just used because of language and culture sounding differently? That's what I'm trying to get at here. Okay, when I read the Christian mystics, they don't seem to be talking about the same thing as the Zen masters. It just doesn't. So it's extremely difficult, as you pointed out, and now you're pointing out, to see how the concepts may relate to the experiences, but hopefully they mediate something of the experiences.
Just briefly, I would argue that you cannot answer the question because there are no available data. Any data that are coming within the particular integral discourses of a certain Buddhism or a certain Christianity. What we can do is bring those discourses into creative electrical tension. But I don't think that you're ever going to get behind it, because you're always going to get behind to whatever discourse you live in.
Right. There's a gentleman behind.
Good, sir.
Thank you. Do you think a Christian...
We can't hear you.
Okay, to the Christian. As opposed to... Do you think a Christian mystic could go beyond relationship and not lose faith and still be a Christian?
Good question.
There's a lot implied in that question, I guess. But I think, let me answer it first indirectly. From the Buddhist side, or even the Hindu side, at a certain stage, took the next step, then you'd get to the non-dual experience, okay? So that's sort of the inverse thing. The thing is so freighted with language that it's hard to answer, because from the Christian perspective, it's not dual at all. Okay, and it's not like you're feeling like it's two separate things. But if I answer it this way and say, from the Christian perspective, I don't see how you can go beyond this transformative union in God, which gets purified of a lot of different conceptual things, and reach some and actually characterize the experiences as in person. Okay.
You got a mic? I just want to get back to what John said before, that there is no way of knowing or no way of comparing traditions, because it's all kind of the way we express our experiences, and the experiences themselves cannot be expressed. But I think there's a dimension that is often left behind in this phenomenology of religious experience, and it's the affection, the dimension of the affectionate outcome of the experience, or the emotion that goes with the experience. And I think that there's a dimension that is not really verbal, and that is not just the apophatic experience, but that does show a kind of real distinction between a Christian experience of ultimate reality and a Buddhist experience of it. I think I had that insight when a professor of mine, who was a specialist in Augustine and an Augustinian himself, was talking about his experience of God as one that made him want to jump up and dance for love of God. And I can't quite imagine that something similar happening in the Buddhist tradition. And we're not talking about concepts here, but about a level of the experience that's not often explored in the comparison between religious experiences in the two traditions. I'm just throwing this out as another...
Did you want to respond to that?
No.
Can I do a quick, I don't know if it's reality or conceptual check here, that if I understand both John and your comment right, it's reinforcing this idea that the model that I've offered is a conceptual understanding Buddhist non-dual model that therefore doesn't really work as a meeting place because it's really importing one particular perspective here, that it doesn't provide, you know, a neutral meta-discourse, but it's simply suggesting that we're always coming from one or the other place. Is that getting at what you were saying?
But I would think every model would be that.
Right, exactly. So if, yeah, if it's inadequate, it's inadequate
even
in the way that all models are.
And I think that's the fun of it, mm-hmm. is when you bring them together, all kinds of sparks should fly. I mean, and when he talks to Swedenborg, I want to say he's a pantheist, you know, and like, what the hell's going on there? And really get into it, because I think I'm talking about discourse. I don't think I'm talking about any kind of an experience that we can get to and say is either the same or different.
But what I am, the implication of what I am saying is that there may be such a difference that any meta-discourse is futile. That's what I'm saying. And it raises the question of why are we looking for a meta-discourse? Why can't we just stand with difference and with radical otherness? Where does this urge to come to a kind of grounding, unifying experience come from? That's sort of the question that comes out of my comment. As intellectuals or academics, maybe we can't help it. We have to do this kind of exercise. But ultimately, the question is, I mean, for an everyday person, they might wonder, indeed, why do we need that kind of meta-discourse?
There's some people over here and then in the back. I think you were here first. Let me just say that insofar as we have the two influxes, okay, back to that. I mean, insofar as we have the understanding influx, I think there is this urge, this move. Is it something we can never escape or want to escape? I don't know. But I think insofar as we're coming out of that, then we want to do this kind of thing. Maybe when we're speaking more from the relational, from the heart, it just doesn't seem important anymore. People here, whatever. Rita? And then pass it to him.
Well, I didn't have my hand up first, but I got the microphone anyway. I think one of the important things to recognize about the purpose of dialogue is that we're not trying to come to a common ground. It's absolutely unnecessary. One of the big things about dialogue is understanding what the other person is actually saying. In many years of dialogue, I've discovered the big problem is for Buddhists to actually understand and hear what Christians are meaning when they say God, and likewise for the Christians in the contexts I've been in. After many years of dialogue, I just came out of the Buddhist-Christian International Theological Encounter, and there were still very fundamental ideas about Buddhism that the Christians simply weren't getting. And these are very high-powered people we're talking about. So this whole business about coming to a common ground strikes me as, what's the point? But understanding, really understanding what a dialogue partner is saying, now that's worthwhile. And what we've discovered in the Kaba Abe group is that we dialogue much better when we give up the whole comparative, are we the same, are we different? And we work on what can we as Buddhists and Christians say about some of the vast common issues we're facing today, like consumerism. We have a lot to say. It's the same, it's different, but we both have a lot to say and a lot to offer. And I think that's what fruitful dialogue is about.
So, John, you would be granting that discourse is a clue, then. Discourses can be a clue,
yes.
Somehow. Yeah, I would agree very much with that, yeah. James, I was a little unsettled, maybe, by your reference to the love relation, love mysticism, as a matter of dualism.
No, it wasn't dualism.
But I got that impression from your speaking about a lover and a loved, right? That there's an ongoing love. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, just keep
please.
It there, it's all right. It's like, from a Christian point of view, you can really talk about an intentional non-duality. Maybe it gets back to what you're saying. From the point of view, by that I mean from the point of view of knowledge and love, there's an intentional duality, a oneness in love and knowledge, but not a oneness by nature. Okay?
Right. There's a phenomenological oneness, if you will.
Ontological point of view. Right. This is not a Buddhist point of view to look at the ontological nature of things, because as David is saying, you're looking at skillful means to get to liberation. But from a Christian point of view, it's legitimate to look at the ontological nature of things. And from that point of view, I couldn't say that I am God.
Right, but I mean, in the Tibetan Gelugpa tradition, for example, there's very much ontological inquiry. It's just the non-findability of the substance, which is founding, if you will. But I think you don't know enough about the position I'm coming from to sense my question. What I really meant was that maybe a way of thinking about the relation between San Juan, for example, and I'm a Carmelite, you know, San Juan and Christ, is as mutual reinscription. In other words, we're not bound to a matter of oneness and two-ness, but rather it could be a question of neither one nor two. And you know, a lot of you know I work in French thought a lot, and contemporary French thought talks a great deal about mutual reinscription. And that is a way of dealing with it, I think, which is a better clue to how San Juan even talks about his mystical experience, because he loses himself in Christ, and the phenomenology of that experience, and even the ontology, on theological grounds, can be explained in terms of mutual reinscription, he and me, and I and him. And that's not captured by our ontological and our numerical definitions of unity, which are the ones that, especially in the West, we're stuck with. And actually, time and space are a kind of double bind. The Buddhists are very sensitive to this notion. That is, if we're undertaking an ontological definition, it's as if we're stopping time and treating everything within the space as a unity. This is one, God is one. And then we also have a numerical definition of one. One, two, three, four. We have one word, one, in English for both of these actions. And then the counting is temporal. So actually, we can never, as humans, capture that one moment in which everything is the same in one space, because time is always moving on, you know. And thus, our notion of oneness or two-ness is very, I think, thwarted by the ontological and temporal things we're stuck with. The mutual reinscription is a better clue to the unity between San Juan and our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what would be my suggestion, maybe.
Let me just comment 1 second on that.
Did we lose part of the mic here somewhere?
Yeah, I think so.
It's in your...
Oh, no, the other... Okay, I guess we don't need this piece.
That's a tie point.
I think maybe we're not really that far apart. I think what, right, because, and I think this is an important thing when, if we want to talk about non-duality, the Christian mystical tradition in a certain way could be called a non-dual tradition, like in John of the Cross, or some other better way of saying it, like you're suggesting. At the same time, it is also part of the Christian tradition to reflect on this in a kind of metaphysical or ontological way, in which we would not end up saying certain things you could say perhaps in Advaita or somewhere else, where you identify God and the human person.
I guess I'm very, very much a newcomer to this dialogue, and so in response to Rita, I would just say it is actually very helpful for me to listen to the dialogue around differences, because I'm learning a lot. And as Protestant boy who grew up in the Midwest of Canada in a congregation that could be called or described as the Frozen Chosen. To my novice ears, it seems to me that there is a much greater gulf between devotional Christianity and mystic Christianity than there is between mystical Christianity and Buddhist meditation. And I can't speak to the Buddhist side in terms of if there is that difference between devotional Buddhism and mystical or contemplative Buddhism. But it seems to me that there's a lot more in common here than there is even within different aspects of Christianity.
Okay, since I have the mic, I'll just make one comment on that. I'm not sure the gap is that big from where I'm sitting. We'll take the example of John of the Cross, and we're bringing him up simply because I think he's a very good representative of the Christian mystical tradition. Here was someone who had this wonderful mystical life, but it never took him away from the normal devotional practices of his time. Nor did it even take him away from the normal scholastic thought of his time, which he was quite adept in. So in that example, there wasn't that big a gulf.
It seems to me the word dualism is used as a shibboleth often in religious conversations back where I come from at the University of Kentucky. I'd like to offer a possible clarification or two. One, I think popular religion is likely to be rather dualistic. Certainly there is a duality there. Across the board, I think, in the great world traditions, But as it becomes, I don't like to say more mature or purified, because at the popular level, people like Angela, Foligno, and so forth are there, are they not, and Teresa. But this diminishes. A related point, it seems to me, I'm uncomfortable with the idea of Christianity as dualistic. And I would like to kind of toss it back in the lap of the other side and say that it's non-monist, non-monistic, particularly in the light of things like the Eucharist, if one is taking this as truly the divine presence, or divinization, which is not ex ovo the influx. He uses that word, and it's both effective and intellectual at once. I'm not sure that we need distinctions, a little of Occam's razor.
Do I see Jesus as an obstruction? No. But I see the way that he is often understood as an obstruction. Yeah. Part of my questioning or inquiry into Christianity is here is it's very hard for me, and this is where I have to listen and not make judgments, I get, but it's very hard for me to understand and accept the idea of the uniqueness of Jesus, that at one point in the universe, in one place and time, God came to earth, sent his son, and that was it. From a Buddhist perspective, that's an essential stumbling point. Now, this may be exactly where Rita might say, okay, that's where you've got to listen and you've got to try to understand more, but it's also very tempting for me as a Buddhist to reinterpret that and say, well, it's not at all clear to me from reading the Gospels that Buddha, that Jesus himself was really into that claim. It seems to me something about the way people after him felt it was important to elevate him in that fashion, just as people afterwards elevated the Buddha into a kind of a, source of the universe. And so I don't see that I'm rejecting Jesus or any less inspired by him than I am than when I sort of doubt that special uniqueness. I mean, I see him as embodying better than anyone else I know that opened heart, that infectious open heart. But I don't see that there's anything necessarily unique about him. So in that sense, yeah, he's an obstacle to me.
Well, I think in Buddhist language, AKA karma, it is understood that people arrive with different religious dispositions and that's okay. I think that in Hinduism for sure, and Buddhism to a lesser extent, that is the justification for a multiplicity of religious paths. And I think that we have to come down to the point of understanding that we need a multiplicity of religious paths. Fun, much fun as it is to seek for a common ground and to do affinities and comparisons and arcing sparks and to learn from one another, I would say that the quest for a common ground as the be-all and end-all is monotheism, the one true faith. There must be a one true faith in a different guise. And as long as we dialogue to find the one true faith, that's a problem. What we need now is to understand that religious diversity, religious pluralism is a fact. It's here. It's not a theological problem. It is not a theological problem that we don't always agree at the verbal level. And as John says, I couldn't agree more, we have no data to discover whether at the deep experiential level it's all the same or not. So it's fun to do comparative Buddhist-Christian theology. It's a great deal of fun, but please, we need to make sure that we're not trying to find the one true faith.
Could I just answer that before
answer?
It goes away? Not answer it, but just comment upon it. It seems to me that the dialogue becomes less and less popular. Because it's difficult and people don't know where it's going to go and they don't trust the common ground anyway, and so they just give up and say, well, you be Buddhist, you be Christian, who gives a damn?
Then they fight.
And I guess I think there is a validity to a theological dialogue, a doctrinal dialogue here, not about healing, not about social things, not about service, but about doctrines that will freshen our own traditions. And I would like to see the arc go on. But mainly because it freshens all theological thought from my own particular position as an American, Irish, Catholic of the Anglican Rite who studies Buddhist texts all the time. And I think, you know, that I want to encourage that, I guess. I want to encourage it on this kind of very deep, scholarly, intellectual, theological level. And not collapse it in anything common, and not just be satisfied with alterity and seeing other people as other.
I agree totally with John that Johannine and Chalcedonian Christology is intrinsic to Christianity. I mean, I've spent my whole life studying this, and there is no way I can get away from that, nor do I consider it a bind in which I am caught. What I do think could happen is something like happened when science moved from Newton to Einstein. There was a paradigm shift. And Newton was not rejected, he was retained. But, this is the important point, he was retained through a redefinition of every element in the system. The notion of mass is radically changed when you say mass is energy in a transformation. And likewise, I think the Johannine Chalcedonian vision is perfectly patient of a reinterpretation because it's in itself an extremely enigmatic and subtle vision. In John's case, it's something like Hindu Advaita, where Jesus says, I am in him, he is in me, and so on, and it's very mystical language. And in the case of Chalcedon, the categories are guaranteed to leave a space open. The notions of hypostasis, or of true God, or of true man, what do these words mean? So I think Karl Rahner, Catholic theologians, and Karl Barth among Protestant theologians, both were very aware that these doctrines were offensive to not only to Buddhists and to Jews, but to Christians themselves, because they come to us from the past. And both made a mighty effort to rethink them and to open up the horizon, and with considerable success, I think. And we can go still further in the age of religious dialogue, because neither of those theologians knew anything about Buddhism.
I'm certainly interested in identifying similarities and differences. In practical applications and intolerance and openness, but all of those for me are subordinate to truth. I want to know what is true and what is real. And granted, we have to do those other things I mentioned in order to get at truth, but they can become ends in themselves, and then we lose sight of what, for me, is the primary value here. You know, what is true?